Hello, my name is John Spangle. Welcome to my YouTube channel, Underground. Like I always explain, I come up the title, I was thinking about the underground church in present-day China and Iran, where the outpouring of the Holy Spirit is spreading the gospel, and the church is just expanding. Church is still growing. We're in those latter days. We're in those latter moments, and that's what this channel is all about. I'm not a perfect person by far means, and I make mistakes. I know a couple days ago I was talking to a friend of mine, Mark, and I gave a shout out to his church and stuff, and then later I felt bad the next day, and I decided, you know, I shouldn't have done that. I jumped into doing that, and I should have done that. We have some disagreements on some things, but you know, he's a godly man. We grew up together. I think we got to be on fire. I think we're in the last moments here. But by all means, I'm not a minister. So how can I, you know, talk about ministries and stuff like that when I don't, you know, I'm not a minister. I'm just a simple man. So for my brother in Christ, who's always been there for me, I'm just going to eat crow today. Means when an old man just done something dumb. Thing is, by all means, I'm not perfect, and I don't mind humbling myself and as a man make a mistake. I know some things got on the comment section on my last video. I took those off. I thought that was not a good place to have some talks. But I didn't know. He was trying to get a hold of me, couldn't get a hold of me, so he didn't know how else to do it. So that's how that happened. But yeah, I'm very strict on some things, and then I'm very gung-ho sometimes, and I can't say I'm sorry about that, because we're in that time where we need to be strong for God, and we got to set aside feelings and things, and hit things home and be prepared, because that's the reason why since September I made that commitment to God, and this channel has been abounding, and it's just about giving praises to God, and it's about this is the last moments. I mean, I can't stress it enough. And a lot of people are going to miss the pre-tribulation rapture. That's what this whole channel has become about. And to get that message out. Now, a lot of people, different channels, I know Hanging Out with Stan referred me on his video, and I appreciated it. Gave a call out to me and talked about it. Said, I like John, but he's all about that rapture. So that's just where I'm at in my life. And I keep thinking, should I talk about other things I had before in the past, and then where I'm going, but then at the same time, it just goes back. Now, I am looking at starting tomorrow to do some out of the Old Testament more. I do too much out of the New Testament. There's a lot in the Old Testament about pre-tribulation rapture, and I'm about to get into that. Of course, people will argue, and they will argue, and say there's no such thing as a pre-tribulation rapture, and I get that all the time. Matter of fact, I had that on the last two videos, and a couple of comments got real bad, and I took one person off because they... If they go and comment to me, that's fine. But don't attack my brothers and sisters in Christ. And that bothers me. They were saying, you know, attacking some things that some other people commented on. Bothers me a lot. Just you know, cut the riffraff off. You know, there's no reason for that. But yeah, we have disagreements. So I thought I'd start out telling a story about my brother Mark. This was 3 weeks after I got back from Iraq. I was mad, agitated, frustrated. I spent 16 months in the war zone. Lost a lot of friends. Lost a lot of friends right off the bat. My commander, 3 months after we got back, committed suicide. A lot going on in my life. Divorced my wife. Years later, we remarried after 13 years of divorce. And now we're separated. Should not have remarried her. As I said, I'm not perfect. I may be led by the heart. I was hoping she changed certain ways, and obviously, no. She's happy. She's getting taken care of. I'm paying for everything. It's a long story in itself. Tonight, we didn't eat much. Matter of fact, I got sick. We didn't eat much tonight, me and Jacob. I made sure I got more for him than me. I think I went to Walmart to get them things you fix in a skillet, Oriental Foods. I'm telling you, them Oriental Foods are getting less in a bag. So I'm not too happy about that. But my limited, money budget. I gotta make sure my son gets more. He's 6'8". You know, he's big like a house. I'll go with that story he talks about. I'm sorry. I just a couple stories. One time we were in this house for a couple weeks. It was years ago. We've been here since 2010. 2010 or 2011 is when we moved in this house. And he has Asperger's and he's bipolar, but it's an anger bipolar. He's medicated. And thank goodness insurance takes care of it because that's $2,800 a month for one shot. I can afford it. So that's a blessing from God. There's a misconception. I thought he was trying to shove me out the door. He said he was trying to get out the door out of the way because he was good about control his anger. He'd go for walks. Just we got confused. Well, I wasn't going to have someone shove me out the door. You know, I'm the man of the house, right? Sure enough, I just got a hold of him and put him in the wall. But this is an old house. And so I understand that the 2x4s are actually wider than what they should be. That's how come he fit in there. Got stuck in the wall. It was like, I'm stuck. We couldn't get him out because it went in the whole wall. And my wife at that time was so angry because we'd just been there 2 weeks. And here we got an argument, fight, and I shoved him in the wall. We always talk about that, laugh about that. Oh, she wanted to kill me so bad. And took her. I had this big, huge thing. I had to re-dry wall and paint and stuff. It was something. That's my family. That's the way I am. That's the way we go. So, there's only been a couple times we've got physical, and that's it. So, he's really good-hearted. And he's a blessing. But back to my Mark story. So, I come back from Iraq. I was angry. Everything going on. And my ex-wife at the time, I went in there. She moved while I was over in Iraq to this other place. I don't know what she'd done with the other furniture, but I was mad because I had all this money. And I was like, gotta take care of the kids. So I took all my money to do the house full of furniture. I thought, I want my kids to have a nice home. And so I took my ex-wife to the furniture place. I said, pick furniture for all the rooms. That's where all my money went. And I did have enough money before I went to overseas. And with a little bit of money left over, I was able to get my hot rod truck. Something I shouldn't have. I took my daughter, who was like 12, 13 at the time. We decided to see how fast it'd take dad to go 0 to 60 from a dead stop. And I think it was like 2 blocks or 3 blocks in town. But I shouldn't have done that. As I know, that's a, you know, I'm all big about driving big bad stuff. So anyways, maybe that's a no-no on that part. I shouldn't have done it that one day. And she's like, hey, Dad. I said, hey, you want to see how quick it gets to 60 miles per hour? Area of town where no one was around. She's like, yeah. Boom, went. Because I bought it off a friend of mine who was a doctor in town. And he had it for his son, but he moved on. And it was a truck they used at the quarter track. Down there running, it had a racing cam in it. So, yeah, it's my baby. You know, it's a man thing, you know, gotta have that truck. And I had it for a month, and I knew I was gonna have to give it up because I have 3 kids. I'm divorced, 3 kids, get them every weekend, and in the middle of the week, I get them. I was supposed to have them every other weekend, but I got them every weekend. I made sure of that. And I always checked on them either a Tuesday or Wednesday night. So, always checked on. I put up a lot with my ex-wife and all the group that hanged around with her. So many times I've had people threaten me and stuff. I just want to wring their neck. Anyways, so I got me a van. You know, one of them Dodge Caravans. Yeah, take the kids around. It's all about the kids. Can't be dad going out there and doing this manly thing, the hot rod truck. They've always wanted. Didn't have one in high school or anything like that. You know, that's what it is. And we went up to this, and I've been back maybe a month. So, still on edge. You got to understand with the combat veteran and those veterans, you know, we get that on edge aggressiveness. So, I might have stopped there in town. And I look like a college age. There was 4 guys in the vehicle come up right beside us, SUV. Mark's with me. Got the windows down. And they look in the truck, and the Dodge van, they start saying stuff to us, insulting us, you know, young guys in their 20s, you know, here I'm 39 years old, I should act like, you know, mature man. Well, I just come back from a combat zone, 16 months, you know what I'm saying, I got the aggression in me. So I'm listening to these guys insulting, I'm just, but I could do this, I'm cool. Well, I was they went the straight lane. No, they turned, and I was going straight. And then all of a sudden, it was like, nah, I can't do this. So I did a U-turn. I'm in the front of everybody. Big traffic area. Just a big U-turn. I put that van in there as fast as I could, chasing after these guys. The whole time, Mark's on the dashboard going, no. I went after these guys, man. And then there was two splits, but there were two white vehicles, and I couldn't tell because the tinted windows in back. Now, what are the odds? Well, I didn't know which one was which. So when one went in the parking lot, I thought that was them. And it sounds like my son getting my cat, putting him up for him. Thanks, Jake. And so I went around the corner, and sure enough, that wasn't them. It was some lady. I was about to tackle her. I was about to slam that vehicle, get out, and do what I did in Iraq, throw her out, throw her. You know, it just takes over you. And then I realized there's a lady with two kids. I don't know what she thought. That poor woman, I know she was scared to death. This old guy jumping out, getting ready to get her. And I didn't jump out yet. I was about to. And then I calmed down, and then I realized, hey, I messed up. Should not have done that. Things like that happens, you know. We mess up, but the mature thing to do is say, I messed up. So I jumped the gun two videos ago, endorsing and trying to shout out to my brother's church when there's some things that we disagree on, and I wouldn't say I wouldn't visit. I don't know if I would go there all the time, and that's not him. That's more me. Things I look at things different, you know. When you talk to somebody and explain about something, you expect them to change or to research on something, you know, that's what a minister should do. When, for example, someone called me out a long time ago in one of my videos and saying I was doing something wrong, so I went and did the video to show, and it wasn't just to show that person, it was for myself. Well, let me eat humble pie here and find out if I'm wrong, because I could be, but I want to make sure. So I redid my research from a different viewpoint and redid everything. I didn't even look at my old notes. Redid everything, came out the same thing. And then a lot of people got after that person, you know, made a couple comments. You shouldn't have done that to him. But that's fine. I don't mind that, because he thanked me later, even though I didn't change my viewpoint, but he saw that I looked at that. That's the way to be. You know, we're not perfect. I'm not perfect, but we go back and look at different things to make sure where we're at and things like that. So now I'm going to talk about a couple other people on the list. It's just, well, some things have been going on lately. For one thing, I feel better today in the last 2 days. I changing medications and stuff. It's a lot. I'm going through the VA. So, and a lot of personal things in our life. I talked to my daughter today. Tomorrow she has her operation, and I appreciate the prayers. It's just a lot going on. But I give a shout out to people on the list, just other people referred to go to. I don't always know everything about these people. I'm gonna talk about a couple of them, but I think it's important too. It's not trying to attack, because I had someone tell me about someone attacking some other watchmen. I went there and didn't give a reason for attacking him. He talked to like almost everybody on my list. So you got to be careful of that. But at the same time, there's a reason for this. And I show it to you and you decide. All right, that way. But I always go to hanging out with Stan, Melvin McCover, TOL End Times, Watchman on the Wall 88 by Chad, Watchman Adam, New News by Ross, Generation 2434 by Tyler, Dr. Barry All, End Time Dream and Vision. I listen to Athy Creek by Brett, Minister, J.D. Farrell, Steve Fletcher, 222, Last Days Awakening by Jimmy Root, Prophecy Watchers, Robert Breaker, Chuck Missler. Now, I've only looked at one video, so I haven't really researched this one, but I still give a shout-out because someone asked me to. So for you to go there and discerningly look at it, and that's Fault Line Grace by J.D. Watkins, because he talks about the Bible codes. Because that person asked me, what do you think about the Bible codes? I'm like, I'm all for them. I think we have different levels. And that's why I'm about to talk about this one person here. We have different levels and different abilities. I understand that. I'm a simple man. I tear by, I'm just a small toe on you know, body of Christ. I'm just a small toe. I'm not fancy. I simplify everything, and that's the way I look at everything, just being simple. But I always give a shout-out to Repo Man 64, Mike, because he's been looking for dates. But he's always, I've always noticed, at least the videos I looked at, he's looking for dates. And I did a video a while back about date setters, not to be get too stressed over them. But the thing that bothered me was his last one that he did. I thought it was yesterday or the day before I looked at it. And I apologize for my memory. I have memory issues. I don't remember when. But he was talking about knowing the day and the hour of the rapture. All right? We're not going to know the day or the hour. We cannot. Jesus Christ said we won't. So why look for it? And that's where my disagreement is. Why are you looking for something that Jesus Christ said four times in Scripture you're not going to find? No one knows the day or the hour. That's something we're going over today. Not because of that. I'm going to tell the reason for why I'm doing what I'm doing for the video today. Actually, it had nothing to do with Repo Man 64. It just happened in the timing. But that's my point. Why look for something when you know you're not going to find it? And I know he was saying some other things for the first time I listened to and heard, and I was surprised. One is he don't exactly see us in the Psalm 83 war, October 7th, because it doesn't line up with the calendar. Well, who cares? I said, there's four, people understand there's four calendars out there, and there's a reason for it, and I'll get into the video about that, why there's a misconfusion about time. It's on purpose, and it's not by God, even though God allows it. There's a reason for this. But, and I don't say brothers and sisters cannot have the gift to look at different things, because Dr. Barry All did an excellent video the other day explaining the time frame in April around Pentecost for a point of time for the pre-tribulation rapture. He's given out other times before, I understand. But he's looking. For me, it's a season. A season's a point of time, because it talks about seasons being a point of time, and we're in that season. So it's a matter of, is it the season now, the fall season? Winter harvest. We're about to, actually the rain season just getting ready to start. They're, you know, rain season right at the end of the harvest. They have the rain season in Israel. Then they have the season of rest. I believe it's within one of those three seasons. It's all a matter of right around there. We're going to go up. That puts it February. I was looking January. Then I was looking February. I'm still looking. March and April. To me, that's not extended out too far. Now, May, I'm like, wait a minute here. But it's all a matter of seeing where the timing is, and we're not going to get it. No one's going to get it. And then I'm going to the reason why. It's not possible to get it. We know when we're close. We know we're close now, but we're not going to get it. And that's spiritually, we're not going to get it. God's made it that we're not going to get it, people. But if you're looking at, to me, it's imminent. It could be today. It could be tomorrow. You know? But the point is this. It's a day that no one's going to pick. Period. That's supernatural. That's from God himself. You're not going to pick today. The other one that broke my heart, but when I researched and saw he was telling the truth, and I should have wrote down, I apologize, because I like to give shout out to people when they help me on things. Watchman River by Tom Cope. I like listening to Watchman River by Tom Cope. But yes, there is a, because I noticed he was talking about some things he was asking for money, but I thought that one was about a shirt that he says he don't get money off of. Well, that's fine. But there's other things that he accepts money and different things, and I understand that. And the person that led me, Scott, I can't remember Scott's last name. I apologize, Scott. Sent me the comment. Scott doesn't like it when, and I agree. It's something we agree with, that you shouldn't make money on this stuff. A minister goes out there, like Mark has been in this ministry for a lot of years, where he's at now. He's worked hard. I'm going to say one thing about him. We may disagree on things, but he put a lot into getting into ministry. And they're like, well, John, you just said, I know. Some things I'm just dead set on, and there's a reason for it. And I don't want to say too much more to him. I'm at back because he knows where I'm at. So, you know, he's going to do what he's going to do in his ministry. But he put a lot of dedication in there. I mean, a lot of dedication into it, because back then he didn't have, now since then he's got his degrees and stuff, but he didn't have degrees, which I disagree. I don't think it should matter if you have a PhD or whatever for being a minister. I think that's ridiculous. That's man's schools. Matter of fact, I had a friend of mine down in Arkansas that went to Bible college later said it almost kept him out of the ministry because he got so mixed up in some stuff. It's crazy. So I said, well, that's man's teachings. And so enough said. Long introduction. Let's get into what's important. I always give out the rapture info. The Bible is written in New Testament, Old Koine Greek, Old Testament Hebrew, a couple of references to Aramaic. You cannot understand the Bible with the Western mindset totally unless you look at the Middle Eastern culture. There's a lot in there to give you understanding. And you're not really going to understand it, like I told my daughter today, unless you're indwelled with the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit guide you. You're not going to get any of it. You've got to be born again. That's why so many people get mixed up on stuff. They're not born again. We keep hearing rapture. The definition of rapture is taken from one spot to another. Most time it means quickly. It also means, I'm sorry, I'm having a lot of back pain, so it's kind of distracting me and gives me indigestion. It's just what I deal with, chronic. And I hate saying it all the time. Ecstasy, passion, and it's a happy occasion. But rapture is English word, it's not in the Bible. Rapture is the English word for rapture, rapturo, which is Latin for the Greek conic word harpazo. Now, how we know where it is in the Bible? By harpazo phrases that are English. Caught up, falling away, departure, translated, taken up, come up hither. There are 11 biblical raptures according to scriptures. I always mention I did a video about 8. Mr. Man helped me out because he told me about Paul and John. I forgot them because of my memory issues. I do have some memory issues because of my health. And then later I was thinking about Isaiah. It wasn't a vision. He actually, and you can read it in there and see that it was true. He was raptured. So there's 11 biblical raptures. My viewpoint of the pre-post-tribulation rapture is there's one all of the above. Well, I take that back. There's one pre, one mid, two post. People don't understand it. They don't understand the scriptures. And I'll get into what they are. 11 biblical scriptures according, raptures according to scriptures. 4 to happen, 7 that's already happened. First one, Enoch, Genesis 5, 21 through 24, Hebrews 11, 5. Elijah, 2 Kings 2, 11. Isaiah 6, 1 through 8. Jesus' ascension. People don't consider that a rapture because it was, they saw him go up, but still. Acts 1, 9 through 11. Philip, Acts 8, 26 through 40. After he baptized the Ethiopian official, he went from one spot to another on earth. He was raptured, just not up to heaven. Paul, 2 Corinthians 2, 12. John, Revelation 4, 1 through 2. Now, the pre-tribulation rapture, but we're waiting on next, like I said, it's imminent. Matthew 24, 36 through 51. 1 Corinthians 15, 51 through 58. 1 Thessalonians 4, 13 through 18. 1 Thessalonians 5, 1 through 11. 2 Thessalonians 2, 1 through 17. With reverence for Revelation 19, 7 through 16, where it talks about the body of Christ, the wedding feast in heaven, then we come down with Christ afterwards on his second coming. And then Amos 8, 11 through 12 talks about where they don't... I can't find scriptures anywhere about God. That is what I believe during the gap time of in between the pre-tribulation rapture and the 70-year tribulation. And I got that from, I like to give credit to people when I get things in scripture. I like to give credit to Mr. Man for helping me on my memory. I call them brain farts I had. End time, dream, and vision. They're the ones that did that, put that out. Now, I watch them guys too, but I don't know. I've heard some things about money with them, so we'll have to see. I think it's important to do these channels. I've had two emails. My oldest son, of course, he doesn't believe in God. He was mocking me the other day. We kind of got into it because I'm having health issues and all kinds of issues with this house, financial issues. I got everything going on right now. It's great. And he's like, but you had a chance for money. That's kind of stupid, ain't you think? I said, Don't call me stupid or I'll knock your teeth in. You're going to hospital. It's going to cost you a bill. Sorry. I don't care if he's a grown man. He's my son. I will not take that talk. This is where I am. Just because I'm a fat old guy, bent over, don't mean I can't do something. I did it the other day at his house. We wrestled around. That was a fun thing. We wrestled around, but it's pretty funny that the fat old guy, it's not heavy breathing at all. And I've got the 32-year-old, 6 foot three, 6 foot four, skinny guy just breathing and leaning on the truck going, and he's looking at me, how? I said, training, son, training. Of course, I train 7 days a week. I get up in the morning, do my martial arts training before I do my Bible study. Because if I wait till later, I can't move as well. So I have to do it in the morning. And it gets me limbered up. Don't get me wrong, it gets me limbered up for a day. So, you know, I'll do, you know, 30 minutes to an hour of training, and then I'll spend, well, it's 8:30 at night, and I've only took a 2-hour break to spend time with the grandson, and I started at 10 o'clock. So it's taken me a while. Let me get back. I got sidetracked being macho junk. So, pre-tribulation rapture, 1 Corinthians 15:15-58. Always throw that out there because they talk about the trumpets and last trump. People seem like, oh, no, that's during the 7-year tribulation. Sometimes I want to just take the towel and throw it in. It's like boxing. We used to do boxing. Throw the towel in, people. There's going to be trumpet sound. Like I did a video about trumpets. Various things the trumpets are used. There'll be a trumpet sound when Jesus Christ comes in the clouds. Because that's a heralding. Also used at the beginning of a wedding when the groom comes for the bride. There'll be a trumpet sound for the dead and Christ to rise up. That's a command trumpet. They'll go up as they come by us. We'll change in the twinkling of the eye. But I do not believe we go up at that point. They'll go up. And then as soon as they go up, because they're up in the clouds, then we get the last trump, nothing to do with the 7-year tribulation trumpets, and we'll go up there and then forever be with Jesus Christ. And I'll show more in Scripture where we're at. Mid-tribulation, two witnesses, Revelation 11:3-12, lie dead in the street for 3.5 days, and then God, they come back to life, and God says, come up hither. Post-tribulation, Revelation 14:14-16, the martyred saints, when it talks about Christ coming with a sickle, brings them in. Revelation 14:17-20, talks about an angel, all to Armageddon. It's like when Philip, when he was raptured from one spot to another on earth, same thing will happen to everybody on earth. He'll be brought to Armageddon for judgment. So yes, Matthew 13 talks about this stuff. People seem to try to use Matthew 13 and say, in different parts of Matthew said, well, they're bringing everybody out. They're coming out and getting their latent stuff. So you've not been raptured up yet. Yes, we have. The 7-year tribulation is for the Jewish people only and for those Gentiles who've not heard the gospel for the pre-tribulation rapture. It shows it very clear in Scripture. I know I'm being sarcastic, but I don't like it when people call me Antichrist and insult me and stuff. Because when they bring Scripture, I take Scripture to show where I get from. I give you this, and they still don't see it. Then they're telling me I'm twisting things. I give a shout-out to my son. He always has that shirt that I love. It bends over. The knight's bending, kneeling. It says, the devil saw me with my head down and thought he had won until I said amen. Now I'm starting to throw out there 2 Thessalonians 2, 10-12, where it talks about, because a person a while back talked about it. And they said, I understand they get deluded. God sends the delusion. But don't they come ungluted, deluded, and are raptured up at the end? I mean, if they, you know, get a chance to be martyred, or if they live through the 7-year tribulation. No, those people that rejected Christ, all right, the pre-tribulation rapture, rejected Christ, they're damned, period. It says so, 2 Thessalonians, plain as could be. Don't have to be 50 verses explaining it, and I don't mean that in a bad way. A lot of people are like, well, you only need one verse to explain it. Now, don't say take one verse and base your theology on it. I have one person who used to believe in pre-tribulation rapture, and he talked about where it says brethren, and we're saying brethren, that means it's a Jewish thing. So when he's talking brethren, Paul, that's actually for Jews, and then twist everything around. No, Paul became a born-again Christian, so he can use brethren for Jewish and for Gentiles. But, yeah, they don't lose their delusion. They're deluded till they're dead or whatever, until judgment. I always put out 100 men and read the Bible. One understood it, 99 judged the other man. Because I get that a lot. People complain to me. Weather low 78. Always give a shout-out to my autistic brother. He always wants to give me something to put on a channel. That's his working for God. He puts warning protesters against Israel. Those people shouldn't protest against Israel. He's correct. Palestinians, people, there's tunnels under every person's house. You didn't think they didn't know they were building them? They voted Hamas in. I get tired of hearing the oppressed of Palestinians when no one else would take care of the Palestinians, but the Israelites did. Gave them housing, gave them hospitalization, everything else. There's a lot of lives being put out there, but I know a lot of people over there in Israel. So I get agitated. All right. Rapture time that no one knows. Stephen MacFon 772 put out something about the meaning. I should have wrote down about his idea of why it says no one knows the day or the hour, but it's not referring to what he was referring to. And so I wanted to show him. I don't like to. Well, it's this. No, let's make a video and break it down simple. That way you see where I'm coming from, and it doesn't. To me, that's not an insulting way. I like doing that, and I like people doing that to me. Then I can figure out things, you know. I can agree or disagree. But so I appreciate this. Now, I've done this as kind of a remake of some videos I did before. So I started this from scratch, redid it, kind of added some different notes in here, and just to be different with it. But we're talking about when Christ says no one knows the day or the hour, about the pre-tribulation rapture. A lot of times when I say rapture, I'm just short for pre-tribulation rapture. That's the next one to happen. No one knows the day or the hour. And it just happened this time. And when I was looking at Repo Man, I saw this. I mean, it's not because of Repo Man, it's this. Because he's looking for the day and the hour, and no one's going to find it. Matter of fact, he referred to a man named Patrick. I forget Patrick's last name. I didn't message Repo Man. I thought, no. I did Patrick, and we back and forth a little bit back in December, and I stopped. Patrick said that the December 6th was going to be the day of the rapture, pre-tribulation rapture. So I text him. No one knows the day of the hour. He texts back, that's your opinion. I sent back the Bible verse. He comes back with, well, that's one verse. There's many others that he uses. So I went back everywhere it said that in the Bible and showed it to him. There's many verses that say that. This is the word of God. And then he come back with more of it. Well, it's your opinion type, looking at, like, that's enough. You know, how many times is Jesus Christ in his own word says no one knows the day or the hour, and yet you don't want to see that. So, and that's where I'm on the verge of, because Repo Man was talking about, well, we have different things we look at, but I understand that. But when you have something simple that anybody can read and say, no one knows the day or the hour, and Jesus says it multiple times, not just once, he's going to give warnings. I'm going to show you other warnings where it's talked about that. And yet you refuse to look at that. It's to the point where it's, are you really searching, or is it a pride thing, or is it for the flesh? That's why I humble myself a lot here. People, well, John, you put yourself down. It's because I want to make sure I'm correct in what I do. It's very important. I saw my brother in Christ. Here I did something, jumped the gun, shouldn't have done what I done, realized my mistake, prayed to God about it with a heavy heart, talked about it yesterday on my video with a heavy heart. And then today I talk about it with a heavy heart after our conversation. So, but we're not going to hit each other. We're brothers in Christ. So we disagree. Big deal. I mean, we've been too many years have we known each other, so it is what it is. Matthew 24, 29 through 31. Immediately after the tribulation of those days shall the sun be dark, and the moon shall not give her, this is Jesus' words, give her light, and the stars from heaven, and the powers of the heavens shall be shaken. And then shall appear the sign of the Son of Man in heaven. Then shall all the tribes of the earth mourn, and they shall see the Son of Man coming in the clouds of heaven with power and great glory. What is his great glory? Which I'm going to explain when he comes. This is his second coming, right? He talks about coming in great glory. What's that great glory? I'm going to show you later that the great glory is us. We're with him, the pre-tribulation saints, and I'll show you. And then he shall send his angels with a great sound of trumpet, and they shall gather together his elect from the four winds, from one end of the heaven to the other. You notice I talked about the Revelation 14. There goes my memory. Revelation 14:16, they go around and gather the martyred saints. Then Revelation 14:17 through 20, all the Armageddon. It's all about this. It comes together. Everything scripture always fits together. Second coming, who or what is Jesus' great glory? And as I said, I got my notes up here, his saints. Then I give a verses to show that. Jude 14 and 15. And Enoch also, the seventh from Adam, prophesied of these, saying, behold, the Lord cometh with 10,000 of his saints. That's his glory. That's us, pre-tribulation saints. To execute judgment upon all, and to convince all that are ungodly among them of their ungodly deeds, which they have ungodly committed, and all their hard speeches, which ungodly sinners have spoken against him. That's the purpose of us coming with him. Jesus' second coming, who comes down from his heaven with him, of course, like I said, is his saints. Revelation 19, 7 through 16. Remember I talked about the wedding in heaven? Revelation 19, 7 through 16. Let us be glad and rejoice and give honor to him, for the marriage of the Lamb is come, and his wife hath made herself ready. And to her was granted that she should be arrayed in fine linen, clean and white, for the fine linen is the righteousness of saints. I put a note here because someone got after me about this, saying, well, what about those that had the blood and the martyred saints? Yes, they will wear white linen too. Absolutely. But they're at the second coming. They're still being martyred. We're up in heaven while they're being martyred. And he saith unto me, write, blessed, and they that which are called unto the marriage supper of the Lamb. He saith unto me, these are the true sayings of God. And I fell out to speak to worship him. And he said unto me, see thou do it not. I am thy fellow servant and thy brethren that have the testimony of Jesus worship God, for the testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy. He was awed by the angel beside him. These angels are great creatures, but understand, they may be in heaven, but they're not really above us. That's something that Satan hated. He was mad about our creation because we will be equal with him. And I saw heaven open, and behold, a white horse, and he that sat on him was called Faithful and True. And in righteousness he doth judge and make war. His eyes were as a flame of fire, and on his head were many crowns. I'll underline this. These crowns are what we gave him. Paul talks about, I'd spend 4 hours if I put everything in this video. Paul talks about crown of righteousness. That is what pre-tribulation saints get for believing in the pre-tribulation rapture and anxiously waiting for Jesus Christ's return. We get a crown that we can lay at his feet. And symbolic, he wears these crowns. And he had a name written that no man knew but he himself. And he was clothed with the vesture dipped in blood, and his name is called the Word of God. And the armies which were in heaven followed him upon white horses, clothed in fine white linen. That is us. And out of his mouth goeth a sharp sword, that with it he should smite the nations, and he shall rule with them with the rod of iron, and the tread of the winepress of the fierceness and the wrath of Almighty God. He hath on his vesture and on his thigh a name written, King of Kings, Lord of Lords. Someone argued with me one time about this. Two locations. Because if it's on his vesture, they wouldn't have to say on his thigh. But it's at two locations. I'll get into that. So what's the timing of Jesus' second coming? Daniel 9, 24 through 27. 70 weeks are determined upon thy people and upon thy holy city to finish the transgression, make an end of sins, and reconciliation for iniquity, and to bring in everlasting righteousness, and seal up the vision of prophecy, and to anoint the most holy. That's the reason for the 70-year tribulation. It's for the Jewish people, not us. We're not here. Now, therefore, and understand that I've got stuck pages. That from the going forth of the commandment to restore and to rebuild Jerusalem unto the Messiah, the prince shall be 7 weeks, 62 weeks. The street shall be built again and in the wall, even in tribulous times, the first 3.5 years. And after 62 weeks shall Messiah be cut off, not for himself, and the people of the prince that shall come to destroy the city and the sanctuary, and the end thereof shall be with a flood, and unto the end of the war desolations are determined. This is Ezekiel 38 war, and when it talks about a flood, it means a lot of people. And he shall confirm the covenant with many for 1 week. Talk about the Antichrist. And in the middle of the week he shall cause the sacrifice and the oblation to cease. And for the overspreading of abominations he shall make it desolate, and even unto the consummation, and that determined shall be poured unto the desolate. So we know at this point the timing of Jesus' second coming is at the end of the 7-year tribulation. And how we know? By two ways. One, 7 years after Antichrist confirms the covenant. And two, 3.5 years after the Antichrist enters the temple, which is also the same day the two witnesses are raptured up, come up hither in Revelation 11, 3 through 12. The same day they go up, Antichrist goes into the temple. Same day. And later you'll learn that's the day when Satan comes down out of heaven. And I'm about to get to that later. We also know that the wedding feast takes place in heaven before Jesus' second coming, due to him returning to earth, surrounded by his saints, the pre-tribulation saints. We also know that the 7-year tribulation is for the Jews only to come to obedience with God. That's what we learned. It's all about obedience. Actually, the whole chapter really defines it and explains it. The church is purified solely by the complete work of Christ on the cross due to the gift of grace. This is why we're not here during the 7-year tribulation. We have the gift of grace that no one else has. The Jewish people don't have that. And there's Gentiles on this earth that don't have that. Why? Because they're in areas that they don't hear the gospel, which they will during the 7-year tribulation. Millions of people come to God. Millions. And I used to think, my memory, I was thinking, no, there's no Gentiles, it's all Jews. Then I got to think, wait a minute, there's Gentiles in different areas that hadn't heard the gospel yet. That's prophecy. 144,000 Jews will go out and evangelize. They'll have the gifts of the Spirit. They'll be able to do everything, miracles. They'll be supernaturally shielded. They'll be able to speak in tongues, speak in other languages, you know, so they can talk to these different areas of people. And then you have the one angel that goes around and spreads the gospel. Then you have the two witnesses for 3.5 years. So, yes, Gentiles will be saved, but these are not the ones that we know that you know, there's many people that go to church that are too vested in this world, and I'll explain later about that, that are going to hell. Can you be a nice person and go to hell? Absolutely. We're not worthy of hell. I mean, heaven. No one is. I don't care how nice you are. You're not worthy of heaven. We're all wretched sinners, but we're saved by the gift of grace. Pre-tribulation rapture by Jesus' own words. Matthew 24, 36 to 51. But of that day and hour knoweth no man, no, not the angels of heaven, not the only the Father. But as the days of Noah were, so shall also the coming of the Son of Man be. For as in the days that were before the flood, they were eating and drinking, marrying and giving in marriage until the day that Noah entered the ark, and knew not until the flood came and took them all away, so shall also the coming of the Son of Man be. Notice, this description of Jesus coming from heaven is a calmer time on earth than his second coming. It can only mean a separate event, as follows. Then shall two be in the field, the one shall be taken, the other left. Two women shall be grinding at the mill, one shall be taken, the other left. This is a clue to a harvest time in Israel. Then we get a warning. Watch therefore, you know not what hour your Lord doth come. Again, we hear that we will not know the hour of Jesus' arrival, and yet date setters are looking for it. Too many people are looking for the day and the hour. I'm not wrong. I don't have a problem with you looking for a time. Like Dr. Barry R. was talking about, there was a time in around Purim in March, and he was talking around Pentecost in April. Time frame, but it's not talking a day. He's talking like 2 or 3 days or something like that. That's not a problem. If you're looking at 2 or 3 days or something like that, you're looking at a time frame. Could it be correct? It could be. I'm not looking at a point in time being a feast day. I'm looking at we're in the season. To me, it's simple. God's simple about everything. It's not complex. Is there Bible codes in that Bible? Absolutely. Can I understand how to get to them? Absolutely not. I'm not that intelligent. The thing is, I know it. You know, I don't say, well, I'm highly intelligent and I know this. I don't. I know what abilities I have, and I discernly understand my abilities. Like Paul talked when he preached about knowing their abilities. You know, that's how we know what our gifts are. I'm just a simple man. I break things down, and that's it. That's all I do. That's all I need to do. But know this, that if the goodman of the house had known in what watch the thief would come, he would have watched and would not have suffered his house to be broken. Therefore, be ready, for in such an hour as you think not, the Son of Man cometh. So we have another warning by Jesus. Who then is a faithful and wise servant, whom his Lord hath made ruler over his household, to give them meat in due season. This is pre-tribulation. I believe this is pre-tribulation rapture doctrine in the right time, which is more than a time frame right now. This is the due season. Whenever it talks about milk or meat, it refers to scripture. So he's saying, give them scripture in due season, as in the right timing. Because it's a blessing for those, because they'll be watching for the rapture. And that's what's happening right now. Blessed is that servant whom his Lord, when he cometh, shall find it so doing. Verily I say unto you that he shall make him ruler over all goods, working for the kingdom. That's right. I know I look at things different, and maybe I take things too far, like with my brother there, but Mark. But we're in the end times. This is it. I believe these ministers shall be need to be shot. Every Sunday and every Bible study, before they do anything, give a rapture info page. You know what I'm saying? Do that. give that information out, then get it, whatever your sermon's about. Because this is it. This is where, watch them on the wall. This is what I'm trying to do, and there's other people on the internet trying to do. And granted, some are taking advantage of the situation and trying to do stuff and make money. And I'm not saying anybody asks for money is trying to do something like that. But, yeah, I mean, this is it. I can't stress it enough. I can't make enough videos. I mean, once we're gone, these videos are gone anyways. You know, the AI is going to take everything off. Like Amos 8, 11 through 12, they can't find anything. Why? It's gone. People, books. Where's your books at? They're burned. They're gone. That's what I believe happens during that gap time. During the gap time, God's taken everything's taken out of God. I know they talk about the one world religion, but they're going to twist things around. And the true God, everything about the true God, it's going to be gone during that period of time. Whether it's a month, it may just be a month. It don't have to be years. I you know, the way things are looking, everything's set up for the rapture now. It's not like they have to go in and do a bunch of stuff. So, but I still think there's a gap of time. And it just may be a month, 2 months. It won't take long to take things away about God. And then during the 7-year tribulation, especially the first part, they're trying to find things and they can't find it. I'm talking about the Jewish people. Let me find my spot. I got lost. But, and if that evil servant shall say in his heart, my Lord delayeth his coming, and shall begin to smite his fellow servants, and to eat and drink with drunken, and which live for the world, the Lord of that servant shall come in a day when he looketh not for him in an hour that he is not aware of, and shall cut him asunder, and point him his portion with the hypocrites. There shall be weeping and gnashing of teeth. In other words, they're not ready. They're living for the world. These are people that, even people that speak against the pre-tribulation rapture. In the previous passages, Jesus gave a clue to a harvest time in Israel, followed by a warning. Then another warning, followed by a story of a wise servant, meet in due season, who is teaching something at an important time, pre-tribulation rapture, before it's too late. We know this by telling about this evil servant not ready and living for this present world, so he goes to hell. There shall be weeping and gnashing of teeth is used throughout Scripture to describe those tormented in hell. They always talk about weeping and gnashing of teeth. I believe anybody that does not see the pre-tribulation rapture doctrine is not going to heaven. I've had so many people argue with me about that, and they're just going to argue. So I put down, what will happen? Well, the pre-tribulation, I love my speech, the pre-tribulation rapture. 1 Thessalonians 4:13 through 18. But I would not have you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning them which are asleep, that ye sorrow not, even as others which have no hope. Well, for we believe that Jesus died and rose up again, even so them also which sleep in Jesus will bring with him. Will God bring with him? He's talking about the souls. Jesus Christ died, went down 3 days. He didn't go just to Hades and get the keys of Hades or show them the keys. He also went to the cross of Abraham's bosom, witnessed. Those souls went to heaven. Because once you die, you're with Jesus. Now, near death, I'm on this real quick. Near death experiences, people, we could be so misled. I know 2 people in my life, one of my brother-in-law who had a near-death experience. And afterwards, I turned him away from God. I know of a minister, I think it was Baptist, had a near-death experience. But if you really go into his doctrine teachings, he's way off. All right? I don't believe in near-death experiences at all. I know people medically. I've seen a lot of stuff. I'm telling you, Satan is a great deceiver. He does things. And we have to be careful because he could pop up here and be an angel. Right? God told you to do something, John. First, I crap my, my pants, but I got a colostomy bag permanent because of cancer, so I'll just fill this sucker up. But the point is this, we could be so deceived, and that's what Satan does. Satan's not at the bar. Satan's not out there here in this place. I'm not saying there's bad stuff in that, at certain places. He's in the churches, and he's been in churches since the beginning. That's where he's been. Church leaders. That's where he's been. That's the reason why it's so important what you show and teach. And let me catch my spot. For this we say unto you, by the word of the Lord, that we which are and remain unto the coming of the Lord shall not prevent them which are asleep. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the voice of trump, and with the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up, harpazo, raptured together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so shall we ever be with the Lord. Wherefore, comfort one another with these words. So it's a comforting. We're not here for the pre-tribulation. I mean, we're not here for the rapture. Boy, if I really missed that. We're not here for the 7-year tribulation. We're here for the rapture. The reason for the pre-tribulation rapture secrecy, it all has to do with spiritual warfare. This is the reason why you're not going to know the day or the hour. Right, we have gifts. We can do different things. You can look at the stars, look at the moon, look at the calendar. There's 4 different calendars. Why is that? Because Satan knows scripture better than us, and he wants to mislead you. But there's a reason for it, and I'm about to go into it. Daniel 10, chapter 10, verses 10 through 21. And behold, on the hand, behold, an hand touched me, which sent me upon my knees and upon the palms of my hands. See, I tell you, angel appears and throws his hand on you. What are you going to do? You'll be macho? Yeah, what's up? No, you're going to be dropping to the ground. I would. And he said unto me, O Daniel, a man greatly beloved, understood the words that I speak unto thee, and stand upright, for unto thee I am now sent. And then when he had spoken this word unto me, I stood trembling. Then said he unto me, Fear not, Daniel, for from the first day that thou didst set thy heart to understand, to chasten thyself before God, thy words were heard, and I have come for thy words. But the prince of kingdom of Persia withstood me 20 days. But lo, Michael, one of the chief princes, came to help me, and I remained there with the kings of Persia. Now I am come to make thee understand with what shall befall thy people in latter days, for yet this vision is for many days. And when he had spoken such words unto me, I set my face toward the ground and became dumb. And behold, one like the similitude of the sons of men touched my lips. Then I opened my mouth and spake and said unto him that stood before me, O my Lord, by the vision my sorrows are turned upon me, and I have retained no strength. Understand, he had been days fasting. It means he just had water. And that's all he had for nearly a month. So he's weak now. For how can a servant of this Lord talk with this my Lord? For as me straightway there remained no strength in me, neither is there strength left in me. But there come again and touch me. One like the appearance of a man, and he strengthened me. And I said, O greatly, beloved, fear not, peace be unto thee. Be strong, yea, be strong. And when he had spoken unto me, I was strengthened and said, Let my Lord speak, for thou hast strengthened me. Then said he, Knowest that thou, wherefore I come unto thee, and now will I return to fight with the prince of Persia, and when I am gone forth to the prince of Greece shall come. But I will show thee that which is noted in the scripture of the truth, and there is none that holdeth with me in these things but Michael, your prince.